Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am very pleased to be here together, and I thank Ken and ACAMP for organizing this event. Really, ACAMP is an excellent opportunity, an excellent catalyst for innovative companies with solid marketing product development skills. And so this session we'll talk about what kind of skill sets we can bring to you. I will start with nanofibers, so just give you the opportunities, tell about what's going on here on the cellulosic fiber side. Before starting the nanofibers and nanocellulose, I like to also bring some breakdown of the nanotechnology firms by industry. This is the data compiled by University of California, basically North American study. And if you look at the nanotechnology distribution, the major part is on the materials, product-based material development, which is 32%. And the consumer applications, which is another 30%, which includes what Ken was including, discussing, like sensors and packaging applications. Obviously, the 23%, which is not in our domain, is the equipment sector. And nanobio, although it's small, but I'm sure the value would be also good, like medical applications and so on. Now, coming from nanotechnology to the province, to Alberta, what are the stakes and where we are? We are really at the intersection of the three industry segments, and we like to see how the nanotechnology and the products we discuss here merge or utilize those three sectors. Obviously, the first one is the forestry, because I am coming mostly from the forestry, forest product sector, although I do also agriculture. If you look at the forestry, is Alberta's fourth biggest industry. The biggest one is obviously energy. The second one is the agriculture. The third one is usually competition between forestry and the tourism. So forestry is either third or the fourth. And it employs around 25,000 people, and the value is around $4 billion. Agriculture is the second biggest industry, has a $10 billion shipment and an extra $3.4 billion value-added products. And we talk about more than 20,000 people employment. The third one is the petrochemicals, which you can see as a subset of the energy segment, although it's not the energy. Nevertheless, it used the feedstock coming from the energy sector, like the natural gas and so on. It has $7 billion worth and more than 6,400 people working, mostly at the Fort Saskatchewan and some at the Red Deer area, making ethylene oxide, and ethylene goes to polyethylene and so on. When we talk about composites, you can imagine what are the stakes here in these three sectors. Now, I come to our domain, my presentation here on the cellulose. So let me ask first question, what is the raw material, a little bit trivia, which is used to make components all the way from computer flat screens to concrete admixtures? Is it coming from oil, or coal, or wood, or corn? The answer is wood. Let me tell you what I meant, although you perhaps don't pay too much attention, but cellulose-based products in different domains in our daily life. Let's start from our laptop computers. The flexible flat screen is made by cellulose acetate. And I can also list all kinds of different materials like drilling fluids, paints, even the stuff going to your foodstuffs like thickeners or textile processing or detergents and cosmetics and drug encapsulation. And obviously here some of the products are disappearing, like we don't see any more cigarette filters making from cellulose acetate tow or the photographic films. Nevertheless, there are new products coming. Look at the headphones made by Sony, which use a nanocellulose, bacterial nanocellulose at the diaphragm, which is a very high-end product. Now, I have a second question. To make all those kind of products, how much the nature needed to produce the lignocellulosic material? Is it in the order of a minute or hour or week or a month? The answer is 1 hour. So it also shows that it is quite sustainable. There is no raw material limitation issue. The materials are ample, and then there is no harm to environment. What I like to reemphasize here, if you look at the nature makes more than 100 billion tons per year lignocellulosic material in the form of wood and other biomass, and only 130 million goes to wood pulp, and out of that 5 million goes to cellulose, purified pure cellulose, and out of that only 2 million goes to plastics and polymers made by cellulose. Then it means that there's quite a room to make this polymers and plastics. I make an analogy, although it's a little bit stretched from famous, there's plenty of room, and how we can make the room by nanofibers and nanocellulose, which I'll come later. Why we like cellulose? We like cellulose for different reasons. If you look at from consumer's point of view, first of all, high performance and non-toxic. If you look at from environmentalist point of view, renewable, carbon neutral, and biodegradable within the reasonable time. And from medical point of view, if you look at the medical applications, biocompatible, non-toxic, and there are unique functionalities. And from industrial point of view, like a pulp producer or the fiber processor like hemp or flax producer, it is an excellent material to make value-added products. And also, it's an opportunity to revitalize the forest industry or the bring new opportunities to the agricultural sector. From our point of view, as a scientist, we like cellulose because of its unique structure. There is no material like that by synthesizing or synthetic polymers. And there are unique hydrophilic, stereogenic, and reactivity, and so on. It's very interesting from scientific point of view. So if you look at cellulose just as a fiber, cellulose is a very uniform material. There are no branches, although the overall chemical formula is exactly like starch, but it is not like starch. Starch, there are two parts. One is a branch, and the other part is linear, and then the conformation is different. But in the case of cellulose, the uniform long chain, there are no branches and very straight polymer, homogeneous structure. Because of that, cellulose molecules zip together by hydrogen bonds and then make a crystalline, high crystalline material. There are good things and then not so good things by this nature. Good things make the cellulose an excellent material in terms of strength and so on, but the difficulty for us to process it, since it has a very high crystalline material, it has a high boiling point. Also, you cannot dissolve cellulose in hexane or carbon tetrachloride or so on. You cannot dissolve in a common solvent. Because of that, you cannot process cellulose like a thermoplastic material. For example, have a polyethylene and melt it by extrusion and then blow mold, injection mold, and so on. You cannot do it by using cellulose. Also, since you cannot dissolve in a common solvents, you cannot cast films. You have to work on them. So those things make people think about how to process the cellulose.